Hello everyone, a very warm welcome to my session on demystifying device tree concepts. My name is Priya Dikshit and I work at Samsung Semiconductor India R&D Center. So let's start the session and demystify the concepts. In this presentation, we will be covering what is device tree and why are they needed. We will see a few of the important nodes, or we can say the structure of device tree and how are they compiled. As we know, device tree is passed from bootloader to kernel, or we can say OS. So we would be covering in this presentation all the steps that kernel or OS take in order to extract the information from device tree block file, or we can say the compiled DTS file. Then we would check how different device drivers extract these information provided in the device tree and they use that. Debugging is a lot easier in user space and in kernel space as well, but debugging the device tree can be challenging sometimes. So here we will check different tools available to debug the device tree. And then we will switch to device tree overlay. And the APIs we used for that. We would also check how the overlay is applied from the user space and the kernel space. Lastly, we will cover a few areas where DTO can be used and how this application of a device tree overlay could be a great help for us. What is device tree? Simply, we can understand a device tree as a data structure that describes hardware using nodes. Here, each node has a property pair value. Each node has property value pair describing the characteristic of that particular device. Here, the topmost node is the root node, which is the parent of all the nodes. And then we can have different level of child nodes, where each child will be representing a hardware component, or we can say the device. This device tree is passed down to the OS, and then the OS will decide which driver is to be used for a particular device node. In simple words, this can be done by checking the compatible property. These drivers then use the information provided in the device tree for a specific node, like what will be the interrupt number used, or what would be the clock frequency, etc. Also, a minimum device tree node that is needed to boot a simple operating system will at least include a CPU node, a memory node, and a single UART node for like console outputs. So this diagram just shows that the device tree can be represented as a tree-like structure where each node will have a parent node and may have this child nodes. So a complete hierarchy is there. Here we will be seeing some of the major significances of the device tree. It is very helpful in finding and registering devices in the system. By finding, I mean, for example, the platform devices. The device tree is the standard format to represent this information that is later needed for registering the devices. Also, it helps to get rid of numerous boot files that could increase the kernel size. Because on the system without device tree, this hardware structure is hard-coded and compiled as a part of Linux kernel, for example, the boot files. So when each of the board has its own boot file, that will significantly increase the kernel size, because then each of the boot file will define and creates its own device. Similarly, when the platform changes, the kernel won't boot. So if there is any change in the hardware description, then we need to recompile the kernel. Hence, using this device tree, it helps us to encourage our users of generic subsystem instead of architecture-specific solution, and also provides the multi-platform support. In device tree, we can also pass the runtime configurations. Like we can specify the device to be used for boot output, or we would also know like where the file system location is, or we can also like give the runtime configurations, like I would say UART configurations also we can give here. So in this way, we can also provide the runtime configurations using device tree. Then these are the two important files, the DTSI file and the DTS file. So the file with DTSI extension are the device tree source include file, and the one with DTS extension are device tree source files. So these files with the DTSI extensions are the device tree include files that are included by the .dts file. Generally, the .dtsi files contain the SoC level definitions, and the DTS file contains the board level definitions or board level informations. So after compiling this .dtsi file, so that is included in .dts, the .dtb file is generated, or which is also can be known as a device tree blob file. And this is the compiled DTS file. So all the devices, all the device tree files that are present in the folder ARC, then the architecture and boot DTS. So for example, for ARM, it would be ARC, ARM, boot DTS. And similarly for PowerPC, it can be ARC, PowerPC and boot DTS. So these are a few lines of a DTSI file that I'm just taking an example. Also inside a DTSI file, we can include other DTSI as well, as we can see here. Here this forward slash represent the root node, and these are all the other nodes and their properties. Their properties, bindings and all, we can check more in the device tree specification document. Let me explain this chooser node here. So this node is always a child of root node only, and this does not represent a real device in the system, but it describes the parameter that are chosen by the system firmware at the runtime. Like here we have chosen that the standard output would be at serial 0. And then there are a few child nodes, like this is for power regulation, etc. And this is one of the example of .dts file. Here this dts hyphen v1 signifies that it is the version 1 of DTX syntax. And here the DTSI file that we saw in the previous slide is included. And also, like, more than one DTSI file can be included in the DTS file. And this is the compatible property of the root node, and it contains a list of all the strings starting from the exact name of machine and then optional list of board it is compatible with. And this is sortable, this is sorted from like the most compatible to the least. This way, using this compatible property, the board is identified, or we can say the compatible property provides the data that kernel or the OS needs to identify what machine it is exactly running on. Also, like child nodes compatible property is there, like we can see here. So this is like used to match the device driver for the device. So this is just a short intro of the use of compatible property, and we will see how a device tree is extracted by the kernel, and or we can say how kernel provides the required detail to the device drivers in the upcoming slides. Let us now talk about device tree nodes. So the device tree starts from a root node and has a different level of child nodes. And this root node typically contains the CPU node information. So here the CPU node that represents an execution block that is capable of running an operating system. So one of the properties, say, is clock frequency, which specify the clock speed of the CPU. It can also have this TLB and cache properties, and likely we can here also specify the CPU state. Similarly, we can say, like, we can also give, we can also find if what is, like, if the CPU is dual cores, then two nodes would be there, like CPU 1 and CPU 0. So simply we can say that CPU node is like used to describe each of the CPUs. And this is like a container node that has child node for each CPU. Then there is memory node. So this provides us the memory information. So a memory device node is needed for all the device trees, and it describes the physical memory of the system. And in case if the system has multiple ranges, then multiple memory nodes can be created. And there is one chosen node, this I have already explained. So for here example, also the boot args, that are the boot arguments, we can also pass in the chosen node. And then the alias node. So this alias node shall be at the root of the device tree, and we can say that it specify the full path of the node in the device tree. And then we have the node that contains the bus information. Here are the few example of properties. Few of the properties I have defined, like compatible. This top level compatible property defines the compatible string of the board, as we discussed earlier. And then for SOC, and values are always given with the most specific first to the least specific at the last. This address cell property indicates how many cells of the 32-bit values are needed to form the base address path in the register property. And this size cell indicates the size part of REC property. Then this interrupt controller. So this is a Boolean property that indicates whether the current node is an interrupt controller or not. Then we have interrupt cells that indicates that the number of cells in the interrupt number, in the interrupt property for the selected interrupt controller. Then interrupt parent, so this is a P handle that points to the interrupt controller for the current node. So this is generally a top level interrupt parent definition for the main interrupt controller. So as we understood that the .dtsi file are the SOC specific file, and these are included by the .dts file. And also, like here, there could be more than one DTSI file in the given DTS file. So for compiling these DTS files, we need this DTC, that is the device tree compiler, which converts the human readable device tree source DTS file into the device tree blob file, that is the DTB. And this DTB is passed down to kernel. In Linux, this DTC is located in scripts DTC folder inside the Linux kernel directory. But this device tree can also be installed using this command line, apt-get install device tree compiler. And the format of the data in device tree blob file is also known as FTT, that is the flattened device tree. This FTT is accessed in its raw form during very early phase of boot, but this is expanded by the kernel into like internal data structure known as this extended device tree, EDT. So this is done for efficient access during later phase of booting. So this is like the compilation and extraction flow of a device tree file. And this command is used to compile the DTS file. So like DTC is the compiler. Hyphen O signifies the output format, hyphen I signifies the input format, and hyphen small o is here the output file. So here, by using the DTC compiler, we are compiling this test.dts file, and the output here is test.dtb file. Like here also we can see The output format is DTB and the input format is .DTSI file. And let's say we have the final device tree blob file after including the multiple DTSI files. So to get the final device tree, like what it would be looking in the expanded form, we can like convert the DTB to DTS again by using this command. So here the output would be the DTS file and the input would be DTB file. So by running this command on the DTB file, we get the expanded DTS file. So like let us now see how kernel pass this information given in the device tree. So for this, for passing the information given in the device tree to device drivers or to the kernel, we use this libFTT library. This has all the functions for manipulating the FTT, that is the flattened device tree. So the libFTT library takes the input as the .dtb file and then transform it into the flattened format. Let us start from the basics. So as we know that start kernel is the first function that runs in the kernel. And in this start kernel, somewhere we are calling the setup arg function. And inside this, we call this setup machine FTT. So in this function, we pass the physical address of the device tree blob file and do the machine setup. So we obtain the machine desk structure by calling this setup machine FTT function. And this machine desk structure is a big structure that is holding many parameters like architecture number, architecture name, and most importantly, an array of the device tree compatible strings. And we use the root node compatible property to match this machine desk structure. So as we saw earlier, using the compatible property of the root node, which contains a list of strings starting from the exact name and then the optional list of board it is compatible with. So we select the best match by comparing it with the DT compat list in the machine desk structure. So this setup machine FTT is a very important function that will search the machine desk table and select the machine desk which is best matching with the device tree root compatible property. So this way, using the compatible property of the root node, the board is identified. And after the board has been identified and we have done all the early configuration data, and then we call this unflattened device tree function. And this function will convert the data into more efficient runtime representation, that is extended device tree format. Then we can unflatten all the nodes of our device tree using this unflattened DT nodes. And there are different helper functions called back to parse the device tree data, like early in a DT scan chosen one function is there. So that is a helper that is used to parse the chosen node. And we will be seeing a few of these functions that are used for extraction in the upcoming slides. Okay, so we now know that compatible string is used to bind a device with a driver. So we can say that platform drivers are meshed with the platform devices that have the same compatible property. Let us see how device driver uses this device tree structure. So when we register the platform driver, the platform bus will scan for the matching devices. Here we have taken the example of a watchdog driver. We have taken the example, and this module platform driver will initialize the driver. And this off match table tells if a struct device matches the off ID list or not. So this is used by the driver to check whether the platform device present in the system is in the list of the supported device or not. So once this matching is done and the probe function is called, so we can extract all the required properties from the device tree using various off functions. This is one of function, and then this of property U32 is used to find and read an array of 32-bit integers from property, as in it will search for the property in a device node and read a 32-bit value from it. For example, here we are reading this CPU offset value. So these are the few of the many available APIs that we use to extract the information from the device tree. As we can see, all these APIs are starting with of. For example, this of find all nodes, of get CPU node, etc. And almost the purpose is clear by their name. So let us take, say, of find all nodes. So this has this previous node as an argument, and this API is used to get the next node from the device tree. Then this of get CPU node will get the device node associated with the given CPU. This of get parent node is, of get parent, by using this API, we can get the parent of any node. Then we have this of find node by name. So this find a node by its name property, and then we have of find node with property. So this finds a node with the given property name. Here it is given as an argument. And one more is there, of find node by type. So that will find the type, find a node by the device type property. And this of match node API tell if the device node has a matching structure. So here, this device ID matches. So this is the array of the structure to search in. And this struct device node is the device structure to match against. So this is to search in, and this is to match against. This is a very low level function that is used for device matching internally. And this off platform populate is used to populate the platform devices from the device tree data. Similarly, there are many more APIs that are used for extracting the information from device tree. And I have explained a few of them here. And let us now move to for debugging the device tree. So the ARC, then architecture boot DTS makefile. So this makefile have all the list of all the DTB files that would be generated at build time. So let us see the different ways that we can use to debug the device tree. So this PROC device tree and SYS devices provide the data of the flattened device tree and the expanded device tree respectively. So the most simple debugging technique would be to use a DTC, that is the device tree compiler. So then we can use to convert the DTB into extended DTS, and then we can see what the final DTS file looks like. And this could also help us in debugging. And we can somehow debug the device tree using the demessage output as well. Apart from that, a few debugging tools like FDT dump, DT2config, and this DTX diff, we will check in the upcoming slides. And these can be found inside the script DTS, DTC folder in the Linux kernel source. So let us take the FDT dump as the first tool for debugging this device tree. So this FDT dump is a tool to convert the FDT into we can say the device tree source file. So here we pass the DTB and we get something like device tree source file. So, or we can say that FDT dump is used to print a readable version of the flat device tree. So a DTEC compiler is an alternative tool that also has an option to convert the FTT to the source DTS file, and this is like mainly used as well. But FTT differs in some ways. One example would be that it prints this FTT header as comment like here. So this is like the FTT header every FTT file will have. And similarly, other commands are there, like FTT get is used to read data from the device tree, and then FTT put is used to write the property value to the device tree. Then we have this DTX diff. So that is present inside a script DTC folder in kernel as well. So this DTX diff was earlier known as DT diff, and this is used to compare two different device tree. Normal diff or a melt command we can also use for the same purpose, but this provide more detail. So here DTX diff is used to compare to DTX file. And where this DTX file can be a DTS file or a DTB file or the VFS, like a proc device tree, for example. So here we are checking the diff between the DTS file and its corresponding DTB file. So like here we, for example, the diff is showing how compatible property get expanded and how different nodes are expanded in the DTB as compared to the DTS file. So this output is showing the difference between the DTS file and the DTB, or we can say the extended DTS file. Then we have this DT2 config, and this DT2 config is a tool to provide the information about Linux kernel configurations options that are needed by the device tree. We can also use DT2 config hyphen hyphen help for providing all the available options. So here we are running this DT2 config over this DTB file, and here we are passing the current configurations. So DT2 config can also report on whether the kernel configurations options that are needed by the device tree are set correctly or not. So the output of DT2 config is not very trustworthy many times, and we should like verify this ourselves rather than completely relying on it. But this gives us an idea about what all the configurations are actually needed by the device tree. We can cross-verify them it with the currently enabled configurations options. Now we will check about DTO, that is device tree overlay. So why was device tree overlay needed? Let us first try to understand that. So the problem majorly faced with the device tree is that for most platform, it is static representation for the hardware capabilities. And since it is not always possible to know what the hardware will look like prior to booting the system, so this is insufficient for the platform that needs the dynamic changes. In simple words, we can say that once the device tree is passed to the kernel, we can't tweak the parameters that are defined in it. And so that is the basic reason behind the introduction of device tree overlay. So device tree overlay is a method to dynamically insert a device tree fragment into the live device tree and see the effective changes. Simplest example can be if we change the status of a property of device node from disabled to okay, then the corresponding device should be created, or the corresponding node to that device should be created. Let us see the device tree overlay format. So here we can see plugin is the new entry. That was not present for the DTS normal DTS file. So this plugin is used to allow the undefined references to the node that are not present at the compilation time. So the overlay DTS file must have this tag plugin in its header. In simple terms, we can also say that plugin allow us to use the nodes parameter that we want to change, but without the need of having a complete reference and dependencies. So I think this will be more clear in the upcoming examples. And here we can see that overlay can be applied either if we pass the complete path, or we can use the p handle. That is, we can say this is the relative path referred to the net, referred to the particular node. As this overlay node is the one that has all the modifications to be applied to the referred node. Such modifications can be like if you want to add an entirely new node, or we are adding some of the new properties in the existing node, or we are overwriting some of the existing properties with the new value. So this would be more clear in the example coming up in the next slide. And this was like the format of device tree overlay file, like the what would be the format would be looking like. So here are examples. So using DTO, we can completely add a new node, or we can simply tweak some of the properties. For example, if the target property of the DTO exists, then in the main DTS file, then it would be overwritten. And if the target property of the DTO does not exist in the main file, then it is appended to the device tree once the overlay is applied. So for example, in this case, we are having two file, main file.dtc, DTS, sorry. So this is the actual DTS file, while the other one, the overlay file.dts, this is like the overlay file that contains the new changes that we want to include in the device tree. For example, here, since the property, since the status property of MyNode already exists, so after the overlay is applied, there will be a change in the status value of MyNode from disabled to okay. And similarly, the value of my child would be changed from all F to one. And since this new property bar of my node is not present here, so this will be appended at the very last. So we saw how we can override and append the properties to the live device tree. And so when using DTC to compile the device tree overlay file, this extra at the rate symbol is there, and rest all the command is same as we can see. So this extra option at the rate is used to add the symbol nodes in the resulting .dtbo file. This symbol node contains the list of all the nodes that are marked with the label, which is used by the DTO library for the references. So rest all is same as we can see here. And compiled device tree overlay blob use this .dtbo extension. For the previous example, let's say to check what lies in the device tree file after the overlay is applied. So we can build the DTS file from the final DTB using the same DTC command that we have used earlier. So this way we are we are trying to check what would be the final expanded device tree looks like after the overlay is applied. So this is the merge file, and this is the output file after the changes are applied, and we can also see the applied changes here. And here we see that symbol nodes contain a list of all the nodes that are marked with label with the complete path. So that could also be one debugging thing, like if you want to see what is the final device tree looking like, so looks like, so just convert back the DTB file to the DTS file. And now we will be seeing how to apply the overlay from the kernel space. And like the overlay can be applied from all the three stages, the bootloader or from the kernel space or user space. And here we will be seeing how to apply the overlay from kernel space and user space. So for this, config of overlay should be enabled. And after enabling this config of overlay, we can use the following kernel APIs, kernel overlay APIs. Like to apply the overlay, we can use this off overlay FDT apply. And then to remove a particular fragment of the overlay, we can use this int off remove of overlay remove. And if you want to completely remove the overlay, then we will be using this off overlay remove all. So when the device tree overlay are being added, some of the device drivers or subsystem need to see what the device tree overlay would look like before applying the overlay, like before the changes go to the live device tree. So for that, these four notifications are issued, like off overlay pre-apply, off overlay post-apply, off overlay pre-remove, and off overlay post-remove. So in the case of, let's say, pre-apply, so for pre-apply notification, if the notifier returns error, the overlay will be rejected. And these are the two important APIs for registering and unregistering notifications, like off overlay, notifier register, register for notification on overlay application of the device tree node. And this off overlay notifier unregister will unregister notifier for the overlay operations. So like these were few of the very important APIs that we can directly use in any of the device driver to apply the overlay to any of the node. And now we will check how we can apply the overlay from user space. So from user space, the overlay can be applied by using the config fs as a medium. So for this, we need to enable the config overlay and config fs in the kernel. So this is added, this is to add a runtime interface to like use config fs for generic device tree overlay uses. So here, for example, we are building this DTBO CFG driver, and here the DTBO CFG refers to device tree blob configuration file system. And this is developed to serve a user space API for the device tree overlay. And we can get the sample driver from this link. So when we need to copy, we need to copy this driver to the Linux kernel and build the kernel with the sample driver, like we normally build all other drivers. So we will then insert this device tree blobs using kernel by using this config fs virtual file system support. And then we can create this overlay by using this command to apply the overlay. And then for application, we can use these two. Like here we are using the echo command and like redirecting the output to the DTBO folder. And similarly, the cat command can also be used for the same purpose. And to remove the overlay, we can use this RMDIR. Using RMDIR, we can remove the overlay. After the overlay is applied, we can also remove it. So this is just a way, and the detailed overview can be checked from this link. And this DTBO CFG driver to apply the overlay from user space is just an example. And we can create our own mechanism to modify the device tree from user space. And internally, we will be using the same device tree overlay APIs that we checked in the previous slide. And just we will create a medium using the virtual file system for applying the overlay from the user space. So this unit test are some of the tests for device tree system subsystem. They have been designed to test this off interface present in the directory driver off. And it is used to fetch the device information from the unflattened device tree structure. So for the for running these tests, this off unit test should be enabled. This option will test cases for the device tree infrastructure that is executed once at the boot time. So test case dot dtb is the file that is present in this driver of unit test data folder, and this contains all the test data required for executing the unit test. And these unit test execution file is this driver of unit test dot c. So as we know that device tree is a kind of data structure where each node is having one parent node, and also it can have many child nodes. So by running this unit test, we can add different nodes at various level. So in this, like this test, the data attached to the live tree dynamically, and to check if we are able to fetch the data, or in other words, we can say if we are able to parse the properties from the device tree. So since here we are also like attaching the nodes to various parts of device tree, this way, this is also a way to check if we can apply the overlay or not. So these unit tests will be performed at the very end of the booting sequence, and the start of test will be indicated something like start of unit test, and then we will get the summary like how many tests got passed and how many got failed. Excuse me for a second. So like here are the few of the APIs that we use for unit testing of device tree. So this off chain set init will initialize the chain set structure, and this off chain set applies the chain set to the live device tree, and if any error occurs, the partially applied changes are reverted back, and no further test would run for that particular case. This off detach node is used to detach, or we can say unplug a node from the device tree. And this off chain set revert all the applied chain set, and like after the test is done, we will call this API, and we have the initial state of device tree like what it was before the application of these chain set. So we have the initial device tree after all the chain set are revert. And let's say one more example of chain set destroy. So that will destroy the chain set, and the changes to the device tree then cannot be reverted back. Now we will see how device tree overlay application can help us. So the device tree overlay provides a way to modify the overall device tree without having to recompile the complete device tree. So this can be really helpful in debugging and testing. We can tweak the parameters of existing hardware before committing it to the complete device tree. So this is helpful in changing some of the properties and see like how by changing these properties are affecting our system. Also, device tree can be helpful in for the pluggable expansion board identification. So that is based on the pluggable devices. We can modify the existing device tree to serve our purpose. And there could be a lot more use cases based on how we want to use this device tree overlay feature. So with this, I conclude my presentation where we talked about what is device tree and the need and significances. We also talked about how kernel or the OS extract the information from device tree, and how like device driver use this informations. We also saw a few techniques that we can use to debug the device tree, and at last we covered what are a device tree overlay and the APIs and what is the use for that. So I thank you all for taking the time and attending this session. Have a great day ahead. Thank you.